while we're only alive to see you. Exclamation mark. 7. Drawing back and pointing, Stephen said with bitterness, "It is the symbol of Irish art. A cracked looking glass of a servant." Buck Mulligan suddenly linked his arm in Stephen's and walked with him round the tower, his razor and mirror clacking in the pocket where he had thrust them. "It's not fair to tease you like that, Pinch, is it?" he said kindly. "God knows you have more spirit than any of them." He parried again. "He fears the lancet of my heart as I fear that of his." He told Stephen then. "Cracked looking glass of a servant. Tell that to the oxy chap downstairs and touch him for a guinea. He's stinking with money and thinks you're not a gentleman. His old fellow made his tin by selling jalap to Zulus or some bloody swindle or other. God, Pinch, if you and I could only work together, we might do something for the island." Tell and I did. Brandy's arm. His arm. "And to think of your having to beg from me, swine. I'm the only one that knows what you are. Why don't you trust me more? What have? Faces. You up your nose against me. Is it game? If he makes any noise here, I'll bring down Seymour and you give him a ragging horse that they gave 5 cents for." Young shouts of money voices and 5 cents for being they hold their wrists with laughter, one clasping another. "Oh, I shall expire one. Break the news to her gently, Aubrey. I shall die." With slit ribbons of his shirt within the air, he hops and hobbles round the table, with trousers down at heels, chased by aides of Magdalene with the sailor's spears. A scared cow's face filled with marmalade. "I don't want to give you back. Don't you play the giddy ox with me." Shouts from the open window startling evening in the quadrangle. A deaf gardener, apron, masked with Matthew Arnold's face, pushes his mower on the somber lawn, watching narrowly the dancing motes of grass palms. To ourselves, new paganism, envelopes. "Let them stay," Stephen said. "There's nothing wrong with him except at night." "Then what is it?" Buck Mulligan asked impatiently. "Cough it up. I'm quite frank with you. What have you against me now?" They halted, looking towards the blunt cape of gray head that lay on the water like the snout of a sleeping whale. Stephen freed his arm quietly. "Do you wish me to tell you?" he asked. "Yes, what is it?" Buck Mulligan answered, "I don't remember anything." He looked in Stephen's face as he spoke. A light wind passed his brow, fanning softly his fair uncombed hair and stirring silver points of anxiety in his eyes. Stephen, depressed by his own voice, said, "Do you remember the first day I went to your house after my mother's death?" Buck Mulligan frowned quickly and said, "What? Where? I can't remember anything. I remember only ideas and sensations. Why? What happened in